We're back from AX and I have living Tombstone sitting next to me so we could record a Kirblog. That's all you get.
Good.
Hi everybody. We're recording this the day after 4th of July Anime Expo is over. My voice is absolutely fucking destroyed. So I'm going to be very quiet and hopefully soothing for this entire Kirblog. And I'm going to let my special guests do most of the talking.
Okay. Let the guy with the red accent do the old talking. Yeah, that's good.
Why don't you go ahead and introduce yourself?
I will. Thank you so much for giving me the floor.
If they haven't already figured it out from the fucking preview image and the description and everything.
Do it anyway. Okay. I'm the Living Tombstone. I'm known online as the guy who does remixes and songs on YouTube. And my real name is Yoav Landau. And yeah, I think that's all I
do. You're known as the guy who does remixes on YouTube.
Yeah.
The only guy.
The only guy. I mean, screw all the people who made EDM remixes, screw Skrillex and Deadmau5 and Aphixia and everyone else. And now
somebody's going to transcribe that out of context and just put that up.
Exactly. And be like, quote that and be like, this guy's such a prick.
Yoav Landau's a fucking asshole. but no, that could not be farther from the truth. Yoav is visiting for, we were here for a little while before AX.
I've been like here in LA just in general?
Yeah.
Like I've been only here for like, since Monday,
okay.
Last week. So it's like, I've been here for a bit before AX and then the weekend happens and AX was insane.
Yeah, we're time traveling. This is going to go up on Saturday, recording this on Tuesday the 5th and Yoav's going home tomorrow, but, he was like, hey, I want to do Kirblog. And I was like, oh, absolutely. What do you got an idea about? And so we wanted to talk about basically making music and being a musician on the internet in general. How many anime subscribers do you have now?
I have 1,700,000.
Jesus Christ.
And it's just going up every day. Like, it's just exponentially growing. But it's an interesting, I watch your blogs, like, from time to time. Like, if it's especially about something that's about more about creative work, then I'm like, okay, I'll listen to all of it because it's always about hearing what other people have to say. That's sometimes really motivating because if someone would say something like how I would feel about working on something, like it would say, sometimes I don't feel like working every day. I'm like, oh my God, me too. I don't feel like working any day, like all the time. So, but it's motivating. So it helps like to be bothered. So I was like, I would like to do a Kirblog where it's like, you know, about as the subject of what I do. And I thought maybe music online could be interesting.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. Well, I mean, this is cool too, because like, I mean, I've been doing mostly stuff focused on like animation and writing and a little bit of voiceover stuff, but this is the first time I've had like one specifically dedicated to music, and I thought you'd be a perfect a success story as perspective, because you know you've very very much made a name for yourself even since we met. And you had already been getting known and doing a lot of stuff at the time that you and I met.
When I first met you, I had like 500,000 subscribers. Jesus. I remember.
I didn't even know you had that many by that point.
Like at this point, it was like just common friends knowing each other and then like connection going on.
It was funny because we met in a Skype call and I was introduced as like, oh yeah, he's my friend from the Brony community and he's a big fan of Parody Rangers. And I was like, oh cool. It was funny because between like you and then Gaijin Goomba and Trailer Drake, who I've also had on the show a couple times.
Right.
They were all like people that went on Newgrounds and like saw a whole lot of like my early stuff from like the mid 2000s and stuff. And I was like, oh my God, now all these people have like, you know, gone on to do all these things. And so all of you guys, of which are all like bigger than me when it comes to YouTube shit in particular. I'm curious. I want to start off with the basic kind of shit, because I actually don't know your sort of origin story. So how did you like get into doing music and then eventually like, you know, YouTube stuff specifically? How did that all kind of start for you?
Right. So I first started like as like primarily as a hobby. Like the way I did it is that when I was, I think it was in elementary, I was like at the age of 8 or 9. I don't particularly remember, but I do remember like someone giving me a CD of like really simple music making software called EJ, which was like the purest form of like a playground for babies to like just, you know, take loops and just see if what happens if this loop would loop two loops would play together in the same time and see how it sounds like, and you would make like really basic songs with that. And that was like for me just an introduction of just like how fun it is to see how you can create something of your own even though it's really basic. And then 4 years down the line, I think I came to know, you know, like after Sorry. So it's like when I first, like at the time, I also discovered Newgrounds, but 4 years down the line, I can discover musicians in Newgrounds to use FL Studio. And with that, I was like, you know, very happy that I can finally get to compose my own music, because with any software like EJ, you cannot do any of that. You can just, you know, take whatever was pre-existing and just loop it. Mm-hmm. But now you can actually compose. So that was something that I took the time to just, you know, learn by myself, like how, you know, certain notes and certain scales would play off each other and have certain ideas and how to take inspiration from what you know and put it there. And it was all for fun. I only knew how to compose at this point, and everything else like mixing, mastering or anything else, I was completely clueless. Not because I didn't want to know, I was dying to know more about the software, but at the time there weren't like YouTube. So if you wanted to learn anything about the software, I had nowhere to go to learn all these things, because if you really wanted to study at this point, you had to like go to a course about mixing and mastering. It's a big official studio.
Yeah, yeah.
And that was the start for basically everyone in the EDM industry. Like, we're basically people who used to be in their bedroom just have a laptop and be like, I want to learn music by myself, because it's way more expensive at this point mm-hmm. to go to a studio to learn everything else.
So when you were in school.
Yeah,
and this, I think this is actually very important to have this kind of grounding, because this is kind of like my equivalent of when I went to, you know, I took a class to learn Flash, and then I eventually went to college to study animation. So you learned like melody composition in school before you actually like knew how to use like programs for making music yourself. Is that right?
Oh, so to explain some of that, I never had any background in music. I did it everything by ear. Like even now I'm doing everything by ear, and I still learn really basic ideas from friends who do learn like theory and stuff.
But, okay.
Yeah.
And then also, so you mentioned, so was the Newgrounds audio portal like a place where you were really learning, like, oh, like there's like programs and like beyond the basic one that you had to like actually make cool sounding shit like this. I want to do this.
It's mix of both. Like, it was interesting because Newgrounds was the only place I knew of that you can listen to someone making music that doesn't sound as professional, but it would still give you a good essence of like knowing that at least you can create something like this at the beginning. Mm-hmm. And it was way more inspirational and motivating for me to make music than it is to listen on the radio and listen to someone making, you know, something way more expensive than this.
Yeah.
So for this was like really important. So Newgrounds was exactly the place I wanted to learn everything, because these were people like myself who just learned everything on their own.
Did you, do you remember any specific people on the audio portal that like were really like inspiring to you, like any particular
songs
or anything?
Yes, definitely. There is a notable, some people that I remember their name of. One was Paragon X9. Mm-hmm. She was like, I think someone from Finland, I think it was, and she was really popular at Newgrounds at the time. Everyone like played her music on the audio portal as like a track that you would hear like in the entrance of the portal. That was LA Gem. That was someone else.
Okay.
That was Lavender Hill Mob. I still remember his name.
Yeah, because that used to be like the theme of the Newgrounds portal for a long time.
Right. Yes. Nowadays, there's nothing. Like, there's nothing.
Yeah, well, I mean, you know, yeah, Newgrounds has changed many times. I'm actually trying to pull up my my account because I wanted to try reminding myself of, like, oh, who are some of the artists that I listen to? Because, kind of a side note, those of you who actually don't know this, if you remember the Rost Forest Super Mario RPG remix that I did my animation to, the guy who did that actually was a Newgrounds guy, mm-hmm. DJ Xbrav. He did the original, like, the robot voice, like, Super Mario RPG, like thing that kind of then led to Martin Hagwell doing his remix, which is what I you know, did my thing off of.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even find my musical favorites. So, oh, here we go. You know what? I think even, that's right, Kadget, who we just saw at Anime Expo,
yeah.
Who's, of course, the lead composer on Tome. He had a bunch of his stuff on Newgrounds, and I remember, I think I heard a lot of it there. And then I think I eventually contacted him, and there was the whole mix of, like, oh, he's the Over 9000 guy and everything, which is kind of funny. But anyway, back to you, though.
So I was mentioning Paragon X9. Mr. Simon was a huge reason why I started with FL Studio.
Yeah, yeah.
Because he was the only one that, at the time, he had his own website, so he could just upload, like, a bunch of Flash videos of him explaining how FL Studio works. So that's how I learned in the very beginning.
Oh, he made like tutorials?
He made like really crude tutorials, but it was enough for me to know, like, I already knew a lot of the software by heart. So all he needed to explain to me that this does this. And I was like, oh, okay. So then I started to do everything on my own.
That's actually really cool. I didn't know that. Mr. Simon is like hilarious. I know him primarily for his YouTube poops, but his music stuff is fantastic as well.
Yeah, like at that time, he was one of those that had like really creative ideas. I think it was the Pokemon drum and bass remix that he did was like the one that he also made like a very, very extensive breakdown video where he explained like how the project file worked. So yeah. That was really cool to see that and learn from that.
Love his South Park Snowtown one that he did a long time ago.
Let's see who else I remember from Newgrounds. It was like, it's mostly those two people that I remember the most, just because Paragon X9 was the one that was overplayed on Newgrounds because she was like known for making expensive sounding music.
Yeah.
I know there was like some people with humble beginnings there. Like I think it was X-Core that big started as a Newgrounder there, and he made like music for the Madness series. Like he made one track for that.
Oh, cool.
Made like one track, and then like right after that he had to leave Newgrounds because he had to pursue his career in making music.
Professionally.
You always make music, but it was like actually like professional for a label and everything.
So I guess perhaps the next step is, if you don't mind my delving into this territory a little bit, so how did your era in the My Little Pony community sort of end up?
So at that point, like after being with Newgrounds and after just finally moving to YouTube, I think like My Little Pony was interesting because it was... it is like the show that everyone talks about because it's a big because it's a show that the wrong demographic got latched on into it and everyone started watching it. And I started watching it too for pretty much like most of my friends, same reasons. Like we watched it because the animation was fantastic.
And
it
great,
was,
great stories. Yeah. And stuff. Yeah.
The writing was good and the voice acting is phenomenal. Everyone who worked on this was like really legit amazing at it, and it just sparked like an entire fandom.
I can't believe that was 2010 that started.
Yeah.
So was it right when the show came out, or was it a little bit after?
Yeah, about the same time, because it was like the first season almost ended, and then like a lot of people joined in the fandom and started to make original work based on the show.
So yeah, like I mean, there's so many. You know, musicians who have, I mean, like yourself, they've become like massive hits, like all over YouTube and like SoundCloud and stuff like that.
Right.
You know, a lot of different guys. And, you know, what was it about that? I mean, obviously the show itself is great, which is where like, I wouldn't even say the wrong demographic, but I guess an unexpected one, if anything.
I don't know. Like I say wrong because it's more like what they intended. They wanted like little boys and girls to watch it and their parents to watch it with them.
Yeah.
Which is why they added all this, nods to like popular culture that they know of.
Mm-hmm.
And it just so happened that, you know, people like us who loves animation in general didn't care that it was for the wrong kind of people. We just watched it because it happened to resonate with a lot of us and we still watched it regardless.
But what was it about that show that like lent itself so much to like making cool remixes, or was it just because like it was such a big thing at the time that it was just like so like ingrained in everybody?
I think like the biggest like competitor to that is Homestuck. Mm-hmm. And I'll explain why. Like Homestuck and like My Little Pony, and I could be wrong about Homestuck because I haven't watched like read so much of it.
Mm-hmm.
But I do know that like Homestuck, you have the power like to, because the universe is so self-expanding,
mm-hmm.
you can just say like that, like you could basically say like that character, like he doesn't exist in the show, but he could be mine and I could be, you know, making make believe that this character is part of that universe. And that's why a lot of us created OCs regardless of, and it never felt like we were like out of it because the universe is so big, you can just invent whatever you want and it still kind of like makes sense because, you know, you can make out of it whatever you want. That's why we created like original songs that always resonated with some idea of what we felt was right.
Mm-hmm.
And with that, you also discover very similar, like-minded people, especially with, you know, artists, because sometimes you can be competitive with others, but in this case, it felt like because we were all watching the same show, that it was normal for us to talk to each other about how to make music, because we felt like it was one big home that mm-hmm. we could just, you know, talk about whatever, and it didn't feel like it was competitive, because it was all for the same stream, basically.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because both Homestuck and MLP were supremely popular around that same period of time.
Right.
With Homestuck, like the soundtrack by not just Toby, but of course all the different guest musicians and stuff that worked on it. The soundtrack was a big part of the appeal, I think, of that series. Mm-hmm. My Little Pony, not to take any kind of like dig at the musicians of that show, because they're very talented too.
Right,
but yeah. I feel like the music of that show wasn't like an aspect of it so much at the forefront that was like, because you know there are fan remixes of the themes from Homestuck, but a lot of the MLP remixes that I heard, not just from you but from other folks kind of around that same starting point,
mm-hmm.
Were more so just like their own compositions that were just using like samples of like, you know, the characters' voices and you know, like different scenes and you know, stuff like that. So it was kind of like a whole, it like they were very different kind of I guess styles, you could say, of you know, fan remixes and arrangements and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, that was like a pretty fair amount of time, and that led to, of course, like, you know, you doing a lot of these conventions and, you know, and becoming like a pretty massive name on YouTube and otherwise. So what was that? I mean, obviously, of course, there's been, you know, some bumps in the MLP fandom's history, I suppose.
But like, it's more like I see like there was definitely like drama in fandom in sure. this fandom, but I see like in every fandom there's drama because there's people who think they're more entitled to talk about whatever they want, and mm. you feel like it's like I can see the passion behind, you know, sparking drama, but it feels like it's just as much as, you know, who screams the loudest kind of thing.
Yeah.
And that led to some people to be very famous because of that. Like, I'm not gonna mention any names because that's just gonna be more to their benefit.
Right.
But so it's like,
my question was like, yeah, during no, that's okay. During that time, like, was that still like an overall enjoyable time of like
being yeah, hell yeah. I mean, there were times where it felt a bit awkward because it felt like some of the fans of the show have different ideas than what I had. Mm-hmm. Like, some of them had like radically different ideas, more like towards being very passionate, very romantic about the characters of the show. And sure. I felt like at this point it's like, I get where you're coming from because it's normal to have this kind of in a fandom, but it feels like it was misrepresented of people like us who were just like normal kids who just liked, you know, the show for what it is, and we made songs because we were passionate about this show as much as we did about any show at the time, I don't remember like what other shows were at the time, because again, MLP is very significant,
mm-hmm.
but if I'm correct, like Lost was still airing maybe, or Breaking Bad was still airing. And there were like many other shows still airing. We were passionate about these shows as much as we did with MLP, and I feel like those drama, those people are very vastly misinterpreted. What the fuck? Whatever that word is.
Take three.
But you get the point. Also because I hate saying that word. It's more like, you know, I feel like it's never about the drama. Like, people can see the drama for what it is, sure, but it's always about the people who are so passionate. Like, I'll give one example. I think the best, like, the diamond in the shining diamond of all music in the Melted Body fandom is this one guy who came by the name of So Great and Powerful, like in one word.
Mm-hmm.
If you look up on YouTube, there's someone who dedicated his time to upload everything that he uploaded, because the guy decided that his music is probably not good enough, or maybe moved on to different things, that he decided to delete his entire account.
Mm-hmm.
And someone else re-uploaded everything. And as this one track called Pinkie Pie Square, which is a name of another musician in the fandom, he was very much a big fan of him. So he played this first track like ever. And it was, I think it's the most beautiful thing I've ever heard, like from the fandom. Like, it has the same chord progression for like from the song. Like, there was, do you know the movie Help, I'm a Fish?
Yeah.
So there was this one song, like, in the very beginning of the movie that had the same chord progression as this song, and it's really, really fucking beautiful.
Huh.
And I would recommend, like, even if you're not a Brony, I don't give a fuck. This song is really, really well made, and I hope, like, whatever the guy is doing nowadays, that he would probably pursue music again, because that track was really, really good.
That's So Great and Powerful.
So his name is So Great and Powerful - Pinkie Pie Swear, also one word. So it's okay. Like, just look it up and...
Pinkie Pie Swear?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because
So you're a fan of this track that this guy, who was a fan of somebody else, named it yes. after. We're going deeper, Leo. Well, this kind of leads into the next portion, which is the freedom of, you know, just kind of, you know, I say this about the internet all the time, the obviously double-edged sword, but the kind of one of the big positive aspects is that you have the freedom of just making whatever the fuck you want and uploading it.
Right.
So what is kind of like a general sort of, maybe not a day for you, but like maybe a week of like just composing music and working on different things, whether it's for your own channel or like as a freelance job or something like that.
Like the process kind of thing?
Yeah.
So the process for the most part is obviously like deciding first on what I want to do. So the way I do that, at least, you know, up until now, was, you know, checking whatever the internet is talking about. If there's like a new show, a new game, and I'm like seeing, like, let's say at the time when Five Nights at Freddy's just first came out, I saw like there was a huge buzz about it. So I bought the game, played it, and I was, you know, impressed by what it was. And I remember like not liking the game that much, but because of how much people talked about the story and what you can find behind it, that was what really got me to think maybe I could like try making a song about it. Mm-hmm. So the way I work on a song, and that's like kind of like a two-step process. Like the first thing I do, like outside of making music in general, is that I would walk, like, let's say, you know, in the mall, and I would like, let's say, be very bored. Mm-hmm. I would like pick up my phone, put it in the voice memo app, and I would just hum in a tune that at the time I thought would be a great idea.
Yeah.
And then once I going back home, I would listen to that tune as best as possible as I can, because sometimes I can sing it very roughly and I don't know what the hell I was singing. But at least that would give me some like good idea of what to compose and try to match it with the lyrics that I have in mind for whatever video game mm-hmm. that I want to write. And that's what I do like pretty much all the time with my songs. Sometimes I have like rare occurrences where I have the lyrics and the melody in mind at the same time. So I would like record it both as I see it. And then like once I'm back home, like I change the lyrics a bit or change the melody. It depends on
if
I feel like it doesn't fit. And then production, I start to use all my different plugins that I have, like and create some presets from scratch in order to make like an original sound, and then basically the whole like thing about mixing and mastering afterwards. And that process, like the time, the whole duration of the whole making that thing, could take up to 2 weeks to up to a month, depends on the situation. And sometimes it could take like, you know, like way more time than usual because I will have this big long break in between, where I'm like, I don't know what to do with this track, I don't know what to do with this.
Mm-hmm.
And then later come back to it when I have like some inspiration and then resume working on it. And that's like basically much it. Like, and I hope like to do more music more often, but it's like sometimes a taxing thing to always think about how to do it better, because...
Well, you want to be hit with like genuine inspiration to make something and not just produce shit for the sake of producing.
Yeah, I mean, because I had a lot of moments like this in my YouTube channel where I felt like I could have done this way better. But I feel like at this point, like when I have this immense like popularity and people know who I am at this point, I really, you know, want to make sure that, you know, that it's more like about if that I have something to prove. Like, I think, like, you don't want to make people feel like, you know, this immense popularity is all for nothing at this point. Like, you say you reach up to your massive like degree of success and then you like fall down because you are just squandering it at this point.
Well, we've had this conversation many times, you know, off mic for like a long time by now.
But right.
One of the things that I'm actually that I'm proud of you for is the fact that I think, by and large, people love your work for your work specifically.
Mm-hmm.
And because, you know, obviously the MLP stuff, and then, you know, more recently, I totally forgot to even mention the Five Nights at Freddy's stuff as well.
Right, yeah.
You know, yes, very much inspired by, this is the big popular pre-existing thing at the time, I'm going to make stuff inspired by this, and then, of course, that's going to do really well. But I think the fact that, like, so many people, and, you know, now well over a million, almost 2 million people have stuck with you and love what it is that you specifically create, regardless of what the subject matter is. And especially because, like, you, even though, I guess, like, you know, first and foremost, people probably think of your dubstep stuff, you know, you're not limited to, like, one flavor of music. Like, you do a lot of different, which was evidenced by the stuff that you did for me on Tome, even when we started working together.
Right, yeah.
Is you don't limit yourself to, like, I'm the guy that does dubstep remixes of whatever. Like, you do anything. You do all these different kinds of things, all of which is really good, as evidenced by the fact that everybody loves what it is that you do. Mm-hmm. And I think that's really, really, like, it's great, because I feel like, especially with the internet, not to go too much into that path, but like on the internet, I feel like that's kind of a rare case where it is just purely the person and what it is that they make, and not them, like, you know, having to leech off of some other thing that is bigger than them, and they're just like, oh, I'm I'm My Little Pony famous, or I'm Homestuck famous, or I'm whatever kind of thing, you know?
Right, yes.
And I think that that is worth being proud of in yourself, you know?
Thank you. I appreciate
You're welcome.
That. Yeah, no, but...
I'm going to touch your pee-pee
now. Oh, my God! Oh, my God, too rude. But thank you. But I feel like, again, as I said, it's like... You have to, at this point on the internet, and that's like the shameful thing about the internet, that a lot of people would expect from you to be always at your best and always make what they want from you and everything,
yeah.
despite being a platform for releasing things for free.
Yeah.
And at some point it feels like it's undervalued or sometimes overvalued, depends on what you see it. And that kind of like brings me to the point of what it means to be, in general, a musician on the internet or making like stuff that... people would often expect to be for free, even though like you would have to waste a lot of time on it. Let me get back at it a bit, because I'm kind of like going back and forth with this. So point is, online, like you have a bunch of fandom musicians. Like I can name like a couple of like Mandapony, Ken Ashcorp, Nate Wants a Battle, and other people who make songs about video games as much as myself. And then with them, like we are not competing with each other or anything like that. But we do have a sense that sometimes it feels undervalued, especially with how we fight YouTube's algorithm with making things a bit more overwhelming and more, you know, easier to digest, because of the fact that YouTube's algorithm doesn't work with that. Like, it doesn't want songs to be always popular.
Yeah,
like, it, sometimes it feels like...
Go on about that forever.
it's like, we understand that. And we, you know, we there's something that's more like, what are we supposed to do? But in the same token... It's our living, and it's basically ours. Basically, trying to say that we want to do this for a living, and we want to do this all the time.
Mm-hmm.
And trying to prove yourself is either, you know, risking your time and money to make something that sounds amazing, but no one's gonna care for it, and wasting no money, no effort to make something that immensely people care about.
Sure, and also of course wanting to like. Make stuff that you personally are interested in and are passionate about.
Oh yeah, that's like always a top priority. People who do it because they have no interest in it, it's like, first of all, people see it right away. Mm-hmm. It's really easy to see that. And second, it just, you know, it's a waste of time. Like even if you don't care about any of that, like why are you wasting your time to do something you don't like, you know, doing a bunch of, I don't know, whatever. Like it's basically this whole general idea of like people just doing it because it's popular and not because they care about it. But that's besides the point.
Well, kind of on a semi-similar note, and we were talking a little bit about this, we were having lunch before we recorded this.
Yeah.
You know, you've also you know, now been working with others in terms, or rather working under others on like, you know, helping with collaborations, but like freelance work and
yeah.
You know, some like professionals, like off YouTube kind of stuff. Obviously, like, you know...
Like, even working for you, if that's the case.
Oh, sure, yeah. I don't even mean to use myself as an example, but, like... well, I'm sure every case is different. Like, what's kind of the general sort of feeling you get from that as compared to when you're just making something for yourself, for your own channel, on your own time and effort, etc.?
Right. I mean, besides the point that you're not making for yourself because it's not your own artistic expression, it's also due to the fact that it's people who... Like 90% of the time, they don't understand like how making music works,
mm-hmm.
and that's fine if you have like thick skin, because you're bound to get so many like pointers about things that doesn't really matter.
Mm-hmm.
Like let's say that the song's too like is like not composed the way they would like it, and then they will not present with an example of reference.
Mm-hmm.
So sometimes you have to act based on principle of what would be more okay with people in general. Like basically thinking to yourself like, okay, what would they like? Like, let's say, how the general public would like it, because I'm assuming that's how they like their music as well. Because pop music, there's certain restraints and bases of how you would like to see it work. Kind of like how you would still paint a painting like based on some mural or some advertisement, because you know that this is how most people will like it,
mm-hmm.
if that makes sense. So it's like, so for me, it's like I always see it as a fun channel, fun challenge. But it's also in the same time, depends if I do it too often, I'm like, I really want to do original stuff again. Like, I don't enjoy working for too long for other people, because it feels like I'm undermining and, sorry, not undermining, just not taking as much time to do what I want to do, because it feels pretty, you know, it's like, it feels a bit depressing, because if you work a lot for other people, depends on who you are, then you start to lose value in yourself and what you make.
Well, I think also what I've kind of picked up on, you know, from my own experiences and from a lot of other people's experiences across lots of different artistic mediums, not just music, is it's a completely different kind of vibe. Like, and typically, I find that most people put like 100%, or maybe even I would say like 120% effort into their own shit. And, you know, even if they are really 100% invested into somebody else's project that they're hired to work on, it's still never like, maybe there's like a subconscious part of themselves that holds themselves back a little bit because it's a job for somebody else and not like entirely their own self-expression. Maybe that's a little too general for me to say. I'm sure that's not the case with everybody, but a lot of people that I've met, and I say this about myself too, is like when I'm doing a freelance job for somebody or working on somebody else's thing, it's different than like when I'm like, I'm making this and I'm like really putting my absolute fucking all into this thing that I'm making, you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, and also I think the other thing too is, I mean, I don't know like the details of like every single client you've ever worked with, but like when I started hiring you kind of towards the end of Tome season one, it started out mainly being just like kind of like guest pieces and stuff like that. And then as we were wrapping up and then eventually gearing up into season two, I had you as like the secondary composer after Kadget, and especially stuff like the Nylock short and episode zero, where I had you completely score the entire thing, and that was mostly arranging based off of Kadget's compositions for the show.
Right. Yeah.
But what I tried to do is give you a fair amount of freedom in terms of like how you wanted to go about doing everything, so that it wasn't just like, all right, I have to get through this, I have to slog through 20 minutes of footage and do all this wall to wall music and have it, because when I hire anybody to work on my projects of any kind, I always try to have it be a fun experience and give them enough leg room to like express themselves and do the best job that they can and want to that extent, so that what we get in the end is like something that benefits both sides, I guess you could say.
Right, yes.
I don't know where I was going with that question.
No, I mean, if I was to follow up that, like you said, you give enough freedom to work on, let's say, episode zero. Like, that's the most recent thing I've done for you that's big that I can, like, remember of. And I know that you said, like, even in the Skype, like, when you first, like, introduced me to the project, you were like, okay, just do, like, whatever you feel is great because I trust you on your decisions. Mm-hmm. I still, like, I know that, first of all, I had visual, like, of exactly what I'm working on. I had, like, dialogues. I had, like, pointers. I had like a number of touches of where exactly where I would place everything, and on top of that, I'd be like, okay, if I'm gonna be the viewer, what exactly would I expect from watching this? And since I watched previous episodes as well, I know it's mostly dialogue driven, and because of that, it's like, okay, music has to be more mellow, music has to be more fitting towards that, and it still has to have the theme that Kadget made in them. So it's like, it was still, regardless of, you know, how freedom I have with this, I can never undermine the importance of how the show works and what the values of what exactly works in everything. Like, I cannot undermine the voice acting, the sound effects, everything else. I mean, once Shitty Vox went to mix everything together and I watched the final episode, I was very pleased and happy that everything just rolled the way that I wanted it. And it never felt like my music was in the front. Because even though I could make the best music in the world, it's still a show that people watch and discover the dialogue and listen to everything that happens there. Like, if it was mostly action, then sure, I can like go crazy. Like in this one episode where I did like 4 or 5 different like layers of the same song, but then we were switching between, which was a very interesting way.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, the Kindred Spirit battle.
Yeah,
that was
like, with that, I was like, okay, I could go crazy and just, you know, make it like as explosive as possible.
Kadget loved that remix for episode 12, which was awesome.
I remember, like, you asked me, like, for the soundtrack, hey, we need to also put a version of that. I'm like, which version? We had, like, 5 different versions. How are we doing that?
Just, I think it, like, kind of switched between them at different points throughout it. That was pretty fun.
Yeah.
From my perspective, too, kind of I don't think I've ever said this on a Kirblog before, but when I'm in your position, not for music, of course, but, like, for animation or voiceover or whatever,
right.
I also try to think of, okay, it's about the end product. And the experience of the people are going to be, you know, watching or listening or hearing or whatever from it needs to come first. And it's not necessarily about my ego and what I think would be best and what I want to do or whatever. It needs to be about the product at the end of the day.
Exactly, yeah.
And of course, like, when you get hired, I mean, most of the time it should be because of, excuse me, what you can bring to the table on the project. Like, you know, I went to you because I loved your music, and I thought that what, you know, you would do on the show would be very appropriate, which was what allowed you that room to be creative with it in the first place.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's kind of like the best, you know, or that's what I try to do on my perspective, and that's what I like when I'm on the opposite side of like a good working relationship where it's not even this, because collabing is a little different in terms of like when you're working with other musicians on something on YouTube.
Right, yes.
But like a big project where there's a lot of different people involved, like that's the kind of environment that I think is the most enjoyable and gets the best end product out of it.
Yeah, I think it more helps when you have like a bigger project with a bigger team, because when you're collabing with just one person, then it's like about how do you fit this other person into this one slice.
Yeah.
And then do everything else. When you have a big project, it's like, it's less about, you know, what other people, like about the other people, it's more about the project itself. And then yeah. It becomes slightly easier in some cases. I always see it like as a much more fun, rewarding experience, because then you can always see yourself in this big machine,
yeah,
rather than seeing yourself as this other set of the car, you know, trying to drive the wheel. It's like the other part breaks down, it's like, okay, I need to make everything work.
Yeah, I mean, that was my position on Tome, but I had a great time doing it, so.
Yeah, yeah.
I actually want to switch over now
okay.
to the next part. I did a little something different with I'm having you be my guinea pig with this new sort of format of having a guest. Is I tweeted a little while before we started recording this of getting some questions from people who are going to be listening to this later off of Twitter. So let's see. Starting off, here's a simple one. Sarah Gonia asked, what software would you recommend starting with for musicians to use for production and mixing, etc.?
That's a very hard question, because you can go with so many different softwares and ways to do it. But I'll go as simple as possible. If you're just starting out, I would honestly still recommend like Audacity, because it's free and you can definitely do everything that most of music softwares can do, which is have basically different layers and just, you know, combining them together. Now Audacity has the option to move the sound in time, so that way you can like sync it up so it all works well and everything.
Uh-huh.
And I even think that it also supports MIDI in some cases. Like there's plugins that work with that to do that. So it's basically the best option if you really want to just save money.
Okay.
Above that, you have the rainbow of digital audio workstations, or DAW, as everyone calls it, mm-hmm. like FL Studio, Ableton, Cubase, Logic for Macintosh computers, and you also have Pro Tools, and you have, you know, Renoise, and so many softwares,
mm-hmm.
Reaper, everything. So it's like, from this point, it's more like you need to look at every software and be like, what do you want to choose? Because it's more like learning a language at this point.
Okay.
I'm used to FL Studio because it's not because I prefer FL Studio over everything else. Like I tried Ableton Live and I loved it, but because I've over 8 years of experience with FL Studio, I'd rather just stay with that than learn something else and just start all over again.
Oh yeah, I mean like Flash is that for me. If I were smart, I would have fucking learned Toon Boom by this point.
I don't think Toon Boom was like, because I know you started early with Flash, and I know that Toon Boom came to be a bit more popular a bit after down the line, like yeah. 6 years later.
Yeah, yeah.
So that's like learning a whole new thing at this point.
I mean, that's a whole other topic. But
yeah,
I mean,
yeah, yeah.
I should do that, but I mean, it's the same kind of thing where like I know Flash's interface so well. And FL Studio is generally like the most common one that I hear from people. I mean, Kajit uses that as well. So I think that's a totally fair example to use.
I mean, there's definitely like arrangement of like musicians, like the ones that I, you know, gave mention before, like Paragon X9 and Mr. Simon were the ones in Newgrounds that used FL Studio as well.
Mm-hmm.
And because of that, I decided to give my own try with that. So if you hear me like say I use FL Studio and you're like, okay, I want to try FL Studio, the good thing about this software is that the trial version is the least limiting from all of them. So it's like, it means that you can use it as many times as you want. The only limitations you have is that you cannot save the project file more than once.
Okay.
But you can still export it into like WAV files and MP3 files, which means, and by the way, that's one of the best experiences you can learn with mixdowns, which means you make an entire project file into one audio file and you say, okay, this sounds good enough. You export it into an MP3, you reload it into the software, and then you make the second layer work with that MP3. And that's like one of the best learning choices, because when you get like more and more like progressive with your project files, you see like how dense and big it is,
huh.
and how much it's going to overload your computer.
Mm-hmm.
So having them saved as audio files will both save you time and also save you the headache of, you know, loading a project file that will not work. Let's say if it's broken, then you're like, oh my God, what am I going to do? Everything is in this project file. You're going to lose everything. So it's better to just save it into slices like that.
Gotcha.
So okay, cool. So FL Studio is a really good learning choice, but everything you want to choose at this point is a good option.
It's whatever you do with it.
Oh, and YouTube is really good for learning everything. Like, seriously, go to YouTube if you're stuck. Like, it's what got
like
me.
Like tutorials, you mean?
Because I'm pretty sure, like, besides knowing the program, you probably want to also learn it. So FL Studio YouTube is for everything, for learning.
Yeah, absolutely. I hope that helps, Sarah.
Yeah.
Harry Milner asked, and we talked a little bit about this before with the Newgrounds Audio Portal stuff, but who are your biggest influences? Any other, like, particular, even like pop music?
I have, stuff? Like, my biggest influencers are, and I think that kind of attributes to what some people call it my style of music, mm-hmm. is because of me being a kid in Israel, you would have a lot of these really, you know, phenomenal musicians that were, like, really popular, and still are, basically. Like Matti Kaspi, Eric Einstein, Danny Sanderson, and many like Israeli musicians that I'm pretty sure a lot of you who probably are not Israeli probably never heard of them. But for me, they were like the people that had this really immense, you know, capability of composing really well.
And if, I have any Israel-based listeners, the fucking top comment, like, woo, yeah, love all those guys.
Like, support your locals. But that's what, like, for me, those were the main influencers. And beyond that, it was, like, listening to pop music, let's say who were, like, particular people. I think, like, people like Michael Jackson were big influencers because I really liked the way that he managed to combine disco influences into, like, funk and everything else into that. And you got, like, the Beatles and the stuff that basically a lot of people heard of. But for me, the biggest, like, outside influence that was also pretty common for me was System of a Down, and they were, like, really big influences for me as well.
Awesome.
Those are basically the biggest people for me.
Okay, cool. Just MCS asked, how do you make your vocal processing on stuff like the Five Nights at Freddy's songs? And do you plan on making any more FL streams on Twitch in the future?
Okay, so the vocal process is pretty painfully easy. It's about, you know, just knowing how to operate the plugin that works with it. Mm-hmm. FL Studio has this thing called Vocodex, which is a vocoder effect that you can enable, which what it does, you take the vocal and you also have a synthesizer with it, and you tell the vocoder to read the vocals and the synthesizer at the same time, and basically use it to modulate and make the vocal play and sound in the same pitch as the synth, basically.
Okay.
You just feed it into it what you want, and then it will know like how to do the rest. And that's basically what I did with Final Fantasy 1 and Final Fantasy 4 and the Splatoon song as well. Mm-hmm. And that's basically it. Like, there's some tutorials on YouTube, like, that basically explain how to use it better. And regarding the second question about FL streams, like, I really want to do that once I actually have, like, I probably move to a different place, and then I'll be able to have, like, a really good internet connection to just support, like, HD.
Yeah.
Because right now in Israel, where I live, it's the upload quality is really bad. It's, like, 3 megs of, like, upload. So, like, it's, like, and I have, like, my family in the house, so if I'm gonna be doing a Twitch stream, it's gonna take everyone else's bandwidth, mm-hmm. and I don't want that. So it's, okay. like, for right now, I'm just gonna be waiting until I move to a different place and have my own internet connection to just do that.
Okay.
And I'll do it like more frequently, because then I really want to, you know, it motivates me to do the streams, because I remember I finished a lot of projects in that time where I was doing a Twitch stream and I did an entire song this way and uploaded it to YouTube. And now I don't do that as often, so I really wish to do that again.
Gotcha. Okay, cool. So look forward to that.
Yay.
Euponia, this sounds like a very specific one.
Okay.
This is interesting. What's the best way for a newbie like me to learn synthesis so that I can create my own leads, growls, etc.?
I mentioned YouTube plenty of times up until now, so I definitely recommend YouTube because it does just that really well.
Are there any specific people that did tutorials?
Yeah, okay. So one really particular person that I would recommend, actually... actually two. So it's like the first one I recommend just for FL Studio, but what he teaches is enough to be kind of universal, because the way you make the same kind of sounds is pretty much common with every synth, because all synths work on oscillators. So if you just learn from him and you have a different software, you would be able to reproduce the same ideas in your software.
Okay.
Just be sure to read the manual, which I always recommend to do. This guy's name is Seamless R. which is a guy who basically provides tutorials for mostly sound design, mm-hmm. And also recommends Cinematics, I think they're called. They're like a group that's recently started out as making like packs of sounds for people to use to make music, and then they decided to expand that and also make a YouTube channel where they teach how to make said, you know, sounds and everything.
Okay, you know, actually, if you text me when you get back later, send me a link to that guy's stuff, and I can have that as like an annotation if you guys want to.
Sure, yeah, I can do that.
Awesome. Let's see, then I'm going to go to, you have retweeted my call to arms,
yep.
From some people. Let's see, Musical Inspirations, Waffle Lord asked, we just answered that. Here's a non-music one. This is a cute one. Skylar Smith asked, what's your favorite thing to do in your spare time?
Other than
furiously masturbate.
But. I was about to say that.
Glad we're on the same page for that one.
fun for the whole family to watch.
No, just you.
No, they watched
it. Ew. Ew.
Yeah, it sounds like such a, like,
You disgust me.
I know. Oh my God. It sounds like a Cards Against Humanity joke. It's like, what do you do when you masturbate? Do it in front of your family.
You've won this hand. I'm assuming you game and shit, right?
Oh, yeah. I play video games. Nowadays, my biggest craze is like Overwatch.
Of course.
But I also, like, I decided to do binge watching on Netflix and just, like, watching whatever people tell me. Like, I know because of you, you talked about Justice League. Mm-hmm. Young Justice, sorry. Justice. I'm starting to binge that and watch that a bit.
Hashtag keep binging YJ, do it.
Yeah,
thank
maybe
you.
New season. No, because I heard, like, not just from you, but everyone else, that the show is great. Also, I'll take the time to watch it.
Awesome.
And basically, we're just watching shows, because I know that watching an episode would take a specific amount of time, and then after that, I can, like, okay, I have to start working, I work on more music or whatever. Mm-hmm. So definitely doing just that and that, basically.
That's good. Kazini asked, were you born awesome or did you become awesome thanks to a radioactive / genetic experiment accident?
What the fuck?
Just say yes.
I would say yes, but I'm too humble and I would say that I'm not awesome.
I'll say it for him. Yes. The answer is yes. Electrodub asked, insight on collabs. How often do you get asked? How many do you take on? And what helps on making a collab project go smoothly?
All right. That's a good question. Also, I want to give a shout out to the guy who asked it. Kojiro is like, he used to be a big Ronnie musician.
Oh, sweet. Hi, Kojiro.
And nowadays I just follow him around because sometimes he still like uploads stuff, but I don't know if he still uploads. If he still uploads music, I'd still like to hear his shit because I like what he does. He has a good voice. Anyway. Collabs, it's like, the
you
very
probably
beginning,
get asked a lot, I imagine, right?
Like, because everyone basically wants to see what happens if, let's say, I have, like, even, like, really fucking amazing people that I don't want to, like right off the bat say who it is because I don't want to jinx it. Mm-hmm. But there are very cool people that are like, I want to see what happens if, you know, we make a song together. And I'm like, I'm the same way. I want to see what happens. At the very beginning, when I started with the Brony fandom, I remember it was much easier to do because we just didn't know how to do it. So we just did it without even thinking.
Yeah.
And over time, I was like, you know, sometimes not so impressed with the collab because then I saw that there could have been more potential to do it better. So nowadays, it's more systematic. So it's like we say, who does the most work here? So let's say I am always down to do the mixing and mastering at the end. But then we always say, okay, you send me the synthesizers and the composition so I can like combine it into my project file and just, you know, try how we work together this way.
Yeah.
For the most part, it's more about he does this very well and I do this very well and we just focus on these attributes rather mm-hmm. than we do the same thing and then no one knows who does what.
Yeah.
So.
And you've worked with Eileen Montgomery a lot.
A lot, because she's such a fantastic voice actor and.
And singer, of course.
Yeah. I mean, voice actor, for me, it's always I don't know why I say voice actor when even it's the singers, because I always see them as multi-talented people with voices.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're right. She's also a really great singer.
And a lovely person.
No, she's a fantastic person.
Shout out to you, Ailey.
Yeah, Ailey.
Monty.
but for them, it's like they're singers, so it's like it's really easy just to tell them that I wrote the entire song and
do the thing and then give it to me and then I will make it amazing sounding.
Yeah, and never pay you ever again because that's a common thing to do on YouTube. No, seriously, I pay people. I'm not that bad. I hope I do. Okay, now I'm really too much into that.
I hope that I pay people.
Like, it's like, I forget, does the money come out of my pocket?
Where,
how does it
where
work?
Am I? Where
what
did
is
I go?
People? What is people.com?
What am I? I'm gonna skip around a little bit. C Crusher P asked, are there any songs you've written that you wish you didn't?
That's my girlfriend, by the way, Crusher
P. Oh, hi.
Hi, Kirshipi, I love you.
Then that's a real personal question.
Yeah, there's some, but she also asked a very good question. I think the Hatria True remix I did recently that I uploaded like a month ago, kind of. I worked on this for like a month.
Uh-huh.
I was really like looking forward for this because I was like, oh my god, I have this crazy idea for a hook and a chorus, and I would be like, this is amazing. I really want to just make this happen. And then I used like my friend's new plugin, which is to make like some people sing.
Uh-huh.
And it worked. And then when I released it, I completely forgot to do the thing that most people do, which is to wait a day to listen to it and be like, okay, does this sound okay or to you or not? And then I completely forgot to do this process and uploaded this just as is. And a lot of people commented that it's not audible, like you cannot hear the vocals so right.
Okay.
And I even listened to it to the point that it was like, oh my god, the mix is bad and just sounds like it's a complete jumbled mess. And even then, like the guy I remixed, like I basically did the song out of,
mm-hmm.
like followed me back on Twitter. Like he was impressed that I actually managed to do this regardless. Mm. So
even your crap is still great.
It's more like that he appreciated the effort I put into this. And I told him like, look, I wish I did this better, honestly. Like I was honest with him. So now it's like we know each other, which is cool. But it's like, and stuff like that, you know, sometimes I would listen to it. Like I think there was, what are the tracks? I think like nowadays I listen to my very first stuff that I uploaded, like the pony stuff.
Yeah.
That would be like, I could have done better. But that's like now talking like 6 years down the line where it's like when I first started that it would be like, you know, listening to something you first started, me like, I could have done better. Obviously, I could have done better. That's what's from when you started.
Yeah, I mean, like, because you and I, we've also talked about this a lot off mic, where, like, even though I very much appreciate that, you know, people like yourself still tell me, like, oh, I loved, you know, Parody Rangers, or even, like, you know, TTA and stuff like that.
Yeah.
You know, not so much I regret making them. I regret, pardon me, things about them, like certain jokes that are like not okay that I would never do now, you know, things like that. But otherwise, it's just kind of like, okay.
Like, I always see it as like a product of its time kind of thing.
Yeah, it's like, this is the skill level that I was, and this is the person that I was at that time. I'm, you know, hopefully better at what I do and better as a person now, you know, because that was 10 years. Parody Rangers is 10 years fucking old.
I know. Old. Like, everything on Newgrounds is so old right now.
Jesus.
Like, and I look at it like as it was like last year because it's such, it's just as significant to me as much as watching TV at the time. It's kind of amazing.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. The answer is yes to your question. also, sorry you couldn't make it to AX Crusher, but I followed you back. Hope you're doing well.
Yeah.
I would love to meet you sometime.
Mm-hmm.
Let's see. Next one. The last glitching asked, are you making iced tea?
No, just lemonade.
No. Well, I had some green tea earlier, and then earlier than that, I had... Oh, no, I didn't.
Oh, you didn't get the joke?
No.
Are you making iced tea is a reference to Tim and Eric, the show they do. So they're like, why sit down with a piece? So it's like, are you making iced tea? Just lemonade. Are you sitting down? Yes, I'm sitting down.
Sorry, last glitching that I'm inept and didn't understand.
No, but it's still cute. It's still adorable. Thank you for the question.
This is also an adorable one. Quick Thinker asked, where and when did you go, I want to make some sweet tunes? Because I'm sure that was just the one moment where you decided that, right?
Wait, what? It's like, what's the reference to?
I don't know.
Where did you go?
I maybe that's just
oh,
a
like the very
statement.
Beginning. Yeah. Okay. I thought it was it like, I thought the way you worded it, because it was like a quotation, like, did I actually say that?
I mean, maybe at one point in your
probably.
Life.
Probably.
Maybe in your native language. How would you say, I want to make some sweet tunes?
No, so it says manginot magnivot.
That was hot.
Yeah.
I got some wood from that. Sorry.
So it's like, I think it was like, if I'm gonna like rephrase that to like how I started, like I kind of talked about this before in this very video, was like, I just started to make that because I was like, I love what they do. I want to do it, you know, like my way, and I want to like try, you know, my own style and just, you know, started making stuff until, you know, I think, you know, something clicked, and over time it just became like a muscle memory kind of thing, where it's like, okay, this works with this, mm-hmm. and then it's like you do everything so quickly at this point that you're like, you kind of remember, like as a separate language almost.
Yeah. Was there maybe, just kind of to add to this question, was there like maybe one particular song, like way back in the day that like made you be like, music, that's the thing I want to do?
Actually, yeah. I remember like my first original Bonnie song that I made was called September, and that was like the one that was like got me to like think like, holy shit, I really love making this, because it can like make, because September was special because at this time I was like ambitious. I was like, let's make a song where there's a 3-act story in that very song. And I would like, you know, have the story where it's like about a pony who like is awakened from a coma, like from like some kind of like, he doesn't remember anything what happened before, but he knows that the entire city is completely destroyed from apparently an atomic bomb. And he would like see all this like dead, you know, ponies on the way. And then towards the end, he realizes that it's actually him from like flashbacks that he started to have during the song. And I was like, holy shit, this is really fun. And it's like, and then from that, it's like started to make more and more songs and be more experienced with that. But I really want to get back to that time where it's like I managed to make some kind of
like a
theatrical kind of like song. Yeah, and yeah. I really like that. It's very hard to do it. Like, I don't know how at the time I managed to do it so quickly and so well. Because even now, like, I listen to this and I'm like, holy shit, this is pretty impressive even for that time.
How old were you when you made that?
I was, I think I was 19 or 18.
Okay.
So it wasn't that long ago. I mean, it was long ago, but it was at the time it was like, everything just clicked, and I'm like, I want to do something like this again. I just need to figure out how I did it and how do I manage to do it, like, well, even better probably, which just, it's very hard to think about.
Yeah, well, no, that is interesting, because, I mean, obviously 19 isn't, like, a little kid age, but, like, I think that there is value to, like, kind of trying to harken back to when, like, you're younger and you're not, like, I guess, like, overanalyzing things too
I was
hard,
also kind of like more naive. I was like more like, you know, whimsical and thinking like I can do everything and just, you know, make everything.
There is value to that.
Like over time, like now I'm 25, so it's like now whenever I make something, I'm like I have to be a bit more systematic and know exactly what I'm doing. Because even when I have like my own hunches about what I want to do, I still need to fall back on theories and things that actually work with so many songs, not just mine. So
awesome.
There's that.
I like this one a lot, actually. Michelle Moranis asked, if you could meet your favorite band, which band would it be? And I'll add to this, what would you say if you met your favorite band?
It's like, first of all, I would say I fucking love you, but it's like...
Aside from that.
Obviously. I would say... Who would I say? Like, I think my biggest... like, I would probably talk to System of a Down.
Okay.
Because they're, like, still the biggest influencers. And I like asked them, like, you know, basically asked them like something that most people didn't ask them, because a lot of people just focus on what genre of music are you? It's like, and it's obvious that they're influenced for so many directions. Like the question is, for me is more like, is your, because they're Armenian. It's like, so my question would be, is your Armenian heritage would be the reason you started to be a band? Mm-hmm. Or was it the fact that you just wanted to make music that it's the reason you wanted to start as a band? Because nowadays they are way more political, but at the time it felt more like they were like teenagers who just wanted to crap around and just make music.
Okay, awesome. Do they tour, actually?
They actually did a show like 2 years ago in LA, and I wasn't here in LA, but I was really bummed out because they were... I have friends who told me they went to that show, and like, oh my god, I don't know when's the next time they'll ever tour, because they're a really old band. Like, at this point, I'm pretty sure that, you know, everyone says they're probably going to make a new album, but no one knows. So it's like, now we have to play the waiting game to see if it actually happens.
I don't know, can I say that, because you might be... moving to the United States.
That would be a possibility. Like, I am right now in the process of doing a lot of things towards that, but that's like, it's all a matter of time.
Sure, but well,
hopefully this year, but who knows?
Well, the reason I asked, I was gonna get to that a little bit later, but I asked now because like, because if you're here and if they, you know, do end up playing somewhere again, then it would be a little bit easier, I imagine, for you to go out and see them, and mayhaps that dream could come true.
I would love to just see them play live. Like, I never get to talk to them, what the fuck? It's like, I just love their music, and just seeing them live for the first time would be amazing. They never, like, play in Israel, so it's like, that's really cool.
And I guess, well, you answered this question already.
like Rice Pirate was like, hey, how so sexy?
Rice Pirate Mixlower asked, how so sexy, to which you
all responded. I was like, from a scale of Coke Zero, Coke to Mountain Dew, I'm Dr. Pepper.
It's like, ooh.
Fucking, I love you, Mick. Hope you're doing well. I guess that's gonna wrap us up.
I don't see
any last couple things that maybe you want to like. Any last other bits of advice or things like that?
The last thing I would say, like, two things. The first thing is that if you seek advice and inspiration from musicians to make music, that, like, I would obviously recommend it. And if it's for me, I would say go do it. Because if you feel like how I was back in elementary, that, you know, you're not good at school, you're not good at anything, and then suddenly you discover that you have this power to make something as creative as music, it would be the best fucking thing you can ever do in your life, because sometimes it could lead you to a career. But even if it doesn't, that's the best thing you can do, because then you feel like you can create out of thin air something that most people could never ever do. Because I have friends who I'm like, it's like I see myself being a musician and I talk to someone else and it's like, how can you not make music? And it's, apparently it's something that it's like, you know, it's like art. You know, some people are good at just drawing stuff and some people are just good at making music and anything else as well. Mm-hmm. So definitely just do it, because you're sometimes you're going to discover just happiness from that, like infinite happiness. And the second thing I want to tell is that I would obviously recommend to check out the Splatoon song video, because that's the one that you participated in making.
Oh, you don't have to. You don't have to.
I feel it's more like, you know, back and forth, basically saying that, you know, you did this for me for my YouTube channel, which I really appreciate, because it was a very fun song.
And it was fun to animate too. Yeah, I had a good time working.
It's like it was very, you know, it, like we both discussed about it being very basic, but it still like worked really phenomenally, because it was exactly that. It was about creating art, and it just looked like pretty abstract and fun to look at and, you know, enjoy what it is. Mm-hmm. So definitely check that out and see the work.
Maybe someday we'll do another music video.
Oh yeah, probably something bigger than a music video, but we'll talk about it in two time.
Yes.
Here's the thing. I want to talk about this so badly, but I don't want to jinx it.
Yeah, yeah.
We're just going to, like, you know, when it comes out, then you'll see and hear about it.
Well, that aside also, any other like upcoming things that you can talk about?
Oh yeah, what I can talk about, I mentioned this briefly on my Twitter. I am gonna start seeing if I can make my own original songs out of, you know, whatever that I have in my personal life than it is to base it on fandoms and video games. Mm-hmm. I want to see if this works. Like, I know for a fact that YouTube does not like original work. It always likes to resonate with whatever is popular. So, like, let's say if I make the next Five Nights at Freddy's song, that would obviously work, but that's because YouTube likes to search for said related things. Mm-hmm. If it's original, then there you go. You're not going to make anything. So it's like, I know it's going to be very difficult, but a big side of me says that now I feel confident to do it. So mm-hmm. It's like, I want to do it because I feel that I'm at the right time where I feel happy with whatever I make, and that I can make original works and focus on that.
Of course. Well, I mean, like I was saying earlier when we started, you know, I think that you've worked up enough people that just love what you do that, you know, when you do start doing completely original stuff, I mean, you basically already have.
Yeah.
I think that everybody's going to like it. And so, everybody in the comments, fucking prove me right and tell him that you want to hear anything he has to offer, including his original stuff. And then fucking maybe that'll give you some confidence boosting to just fucking
I mean, it's like, I always, actually funny enough, like in AX, when I was there, there was this guy who called himself Fritz. Mm-hmm. And like, up until now, like, no one recognized me in the convention because I didn't announce it. I just came because I wanted to say hi to everyone mm-hmm. who I know who are mostly voice actors. Mm-hmm. And then I came there, I was like sitting at Jackson Motors' booth, and then he didn't know who I was because he didn't know how I looked like. And then I told him, like, I am the Living Tombstone. And he started to freak out, like, oh my God, it's you. I'm your biggest fan. And it was adorable. So I was like, dude, are you a musician? Yeah. And then I plugged his band that he performs in on my Twitter, so to help him out. Because I was like, dude, this is the kind of shit that I would expect from my favorite artist on the internet to do for me. Mm-hmm. Because I myself was, you know, just as surprised to do it. And I know that they had occurrences with some big people that didn't give me the time or the space to be nice to me because I was just a fan. Mm-hmm. So I was like, fuck these guys. I want to be the best person I can be for my
fans.
No,
that's awesome. Yeah, yeah. I try to do the same. With the rare times I get recognized at a con or anything, I always try to do the same thing. So that's awesome. Yeah. Well, I guess that's going to wrap us up.
Yeah.
So thanks for pitching this idea. This was
fun. I'm very, very happy to be a participant in Kirblog. I follow it and I love it.
Oh, I'm caressing his leg.
Oh my God, it's so warm.
I guess, that's it. I'll have links to all, I mean, not that they're probably already subscribed to your stuff anyway, but I'll have links to all Yoav's Twitter and YouTube and everything mm-hmm. if you want to check out his stuff. So in the comments below, if you have any, if you have any personal experiences and stories, anything you want to share, like if you've been interested in making music or make music on the side, anything, leave a comment about that. If you have any favorite songs of Yoav's that you want to rave about, leave a comment about that or anything, etc.
And if you want to rave about other things in the comments and be nonsense, you can do that too, because that's YouTube comments in general.
That's true.
But I'm not like talking about you guys making comments. I love you guys. I'm just talking about YouTube comments being garbage
on
in
the
general.
Whole, yes.
Yeah.
And if you have future
Kirblog topic suggestions of any kind in general, leave a comment about that too, or hit me up on Twitter, Tumblr, Facebook, blah, blah, blah. You get it. That's it.
Yep.
So we'll see you all later.
See you guys next time in the next Kirblog. And what's going to be there? He's going to be there. Bye.
Oh, shit. Bye.